Buongiorno a tutti, good morning, I'm Filippo Carducci, I am the head of the neuroimaging lab of the Department of Physiology and Pharmacology of the University of Rome Sapienza, and my main field of research include the use of neuroimaging, in particular multimodal magnetic resonance images, in neuronavigation system to guide the electrical and magnetic brain stimulation techniques. And I hope that the sound is good, and so we can start this webinar. But first of all, I'm sorry, but today I must stay at home. And not in my lab, so I have to change the program of this webinar. And today I illustrate the operating of the last version of the soft-axic neuronavigation system, excluding the procedure that require the use of the tracking system, because this system is in the lab. So I will show you this procedure in the last few days, next few days, and you'll be informed about this. And before to start, I thank all the organizers of this webinar, in particular Dr. Elena Tonelli, the director of CIMEC, Professor Carlo Minuzzi, and Mr. Matteo Giovanelli for the technical support. So, okay. As you are interested in how to use a neuronavigation system for TMS, I suppose, indeed I'm sure, that you agree with me that this is the best way to reach high accuracy in the positioning and the repositioning of the TMS coil. Neuronavigation system guided by MRI data permits an accurate TMS targeting because by taking into account the position and orientation of the coil, the real anatomy of the brain of the subject, and also biophysics property of brain tissues, that, for example, can be used to estimate induced electrical field distribution. So, navigated TMS systems improve technical reliability and comparability in TMS studies, and also enhance the efficacy of TMS therapy in clinical settings. However, as shown in the graph, neuronavigation system for TMS are not so largely used. Only about the 10% of the total number of TMS studies are based on the use of a neuronavigation system. This could be related to a long list of unreplicated results or publication of contradicting outcomes with using identical or similar TMS protocols. As you see in the graph, the number of the TMS publication performed by using a neuronavigation system is very low respect to the total number of TMS publication. These data are coming from the PubMed archive. So, the soft-axic neuronavigation system consists of the following components. We have the soft-axic neuronavigation software and an optical tracking system, the NDI Polaris Spectra or the NDI Polaris Vicra system. The optical tracking system consists of a main unit, the position sensor, and several position tools. The optical tracking system is used to track with high accuracy and reliability the position orientation of each position tool that is inside a specific measurement volume of the main unit. As you see in the figure, the polaris spectra has a bigger measurement volume respect to the polaris vigra. As you can see, the polaris spectra volume includes the whole body, while the volume of the polaris vigra includes only the upper part of the body. This is the main difference between the two systems, the two tracking systems. And the position orientation of the position tools are referred to a global coordinate system. And the origin of this coordinate system is located at the position sensor, and the axes are aligned as shown in the figure. This coordinate system is defined during manufacturing and cannot be changed. While the position tool is a rigid structure with at least three reflective, not collinear spherical markers posed on it. And each position tool as a different spatial arrangement of its marker in order to create a structure with a specific and unique geometry. The unique geometry requirement makes the position sensor able to distinguish the different position tools. Then each position tools has also a specific local coordinate system, and this coordinate system has a specific origin, and the local coordinate system and the position of the origin are defined during manufacturing. The origin is located at the center of a specific marker of the position tool, for example, the marker A, as you see, the marker A in the position tool in the figure here. And there are also the axes that are used to define the local coordinate, coordinate system. And this origin is used to track the position of the tool, and while the local coordinate system is used to track the orientation of the position tool. Both position and orientation of the tool are referred to the global coordinate system of the position sensor. As reported in the slide, all structural information about the position tool, including tool geometry, local coordinate system, and the origin, are stored in a specific ROM file that is named tool definition file, and each position tool has a specific ROM file. While about the position sensor, the position sensor is the main component of the tracking system, and it consists of two noctoplanar sensors with two integrated illuminators. An overview of its operation is as follows. The position sensor emits infrared light from its illuminators, similar to the flash of a conventional camera. The red arrow in the figure are the infrared light that is emitted from a sensor, from an illuminator of the position sensor. Well, this infrared light floods the surrounding areas and reflects back to the sensor from the reflecting surface of the marking of the position tool, the blue arrow in the figure. So the position sensor, as the position sensor see the area from different point of view because the two sensors are not coplanar, so they see the area from different points of view, so the position sensor is able to calculate the position of each marker by means of a triangulation algorithm. Finally, on the basis of the marker displacement and of the structural information provided by the ROM file, the position sensor is able to calculate the position and the orientation of the used position tool that are inside the measurement volume. And at the end, the position sensor transmits all these spatial data to the host computer for collection, display, and also for further elaboration. In the navigation systems, generally the position of the position tool, in the navigation system, generally the position tools are used to track the position and or the orientation of used instruments, as well as of part of the body, for example, the human head. In this case, the position tool is firmly posed onto the instrument or onto the part of the body. In this case, we are interested to track a specific point of the instrument on which the position tool is posed, other than track the position of the origin of the tool. This is possible by means of a calibration procedure. The calibration procedure is a very important procedure because the accuracy of the navigation is based on the accuracy of this procedure. For example, if the tool is stably posed to a steel probe, it is useful to track the position of the tip of the probe instead of the origin of the tool. You see that this is the This is the origin of the position tool, okay? That is also here. And while the tip of the probe is here. So I have to found a transformation, a matrix, a geometric matrix, in order to calculate the coordinates of the tip of the probe instead of the coming from the coordinates of the origin of the tool. So in this case, the aim of the calibration procedure is to calculate the three components of the vector starting from the origin of the tool and ending in the tip of the probe. These components are used to calculate the coordinates of the tip on the basis of the coordinates of the origin of this tool. Okay. Another example is about the TMS coil. If the position tool is posed onto the TMS coil, it is useful to track the position of the focus here, of the focus of the coil instead of the origin of the tool, for example, this marker. So also in this case, I have to calculate the components of this vector. The Softaxic system uses specific position tools to track the position and orientation of specific instruments or part of the body. To be in line with the terms used by the system, from now I will call item the object formed by a position tool placed on an instrument or on a part of the body. The first item that used by the Softaxic neural navigation system is the stylus item. This item is formed by a position tool, the position tool number 340, final number 340, posed onto a steel probe, and this item can be used like a pointer. And this item needs to be calibrated before the first use, before use of this item. The calibration is performed using a specific tool of the NDI coming from the NDI, coming from the manufacturer of the system, that is named NDI Track Tool. And I will show you this procedure in our next meeting. But as you see in the figure, you have to pose the item tip in a divot, and you have to move the stylus item in a sort of cone shape. And but I prefer to show you this procedure in our next meeting. So I don't speak about this slide. Okay, also this. Okay, another item that we have to use for the in the Softaxic neural navigation system is the item named head item, and this is formed by the position tool number 338 that is posed onto the subject head, for example using an elastic band to hold it, and this item is used to create a new coordinate system, the head coordinate system, and this coordinate system permits the subject to move his head during the TMS session without affecting the accuracy of the system. No calibration procedure is required for this item. The new version, in the new version of the Softaxic, it is also possible to use a new head item, and which is placed on two safety goggles, as shown in the picture. In this way, it is not necessary to use the elastic band, and so this item is more comfortable for the subject, and it can also be used in presence of normal eyeglasses, as you see in the figure. Then we have two other items, the coil one item and the coil two item. And in this case, the position tool number 339 or 449 are stably posed onto the TMS coil, forming the coil one item and the coil two item. And these items need to be calibrated before use. And in this case, you can use a specific device, the calibration platform. Here, this is the calibration platform, as you know, and also a specific automatic procedure. And I will show you this procedure in our next meeting, because I need to use the tracking system. The calibration platform is made of plexiglass, and there is a specific calibration platform model to match the coil model that I want to calibrate. And there is a screen printed number and to identify the platform that you have to use for the specific coil. And as the calibration platform are provided by four passive spheres, and also there is also a specific definition tool, definition tool file, ROM file. So also the calibration platform, making a sort of position tool applied onto an instrument. So also the calibration platform is an item for the Softaxic neural navigation system. There is also the possibility to use a manual calibration for the coil one and the coil two item. And in this kind of calibration, the stylus item is used to record the position of three specific points of the coil, the focus coil, a point of the left wings, and the point towards the handle. These three points must be located on the side of the coil that is placed onto the subject's head. And in the next meeting, we will see also this manual calibration procedure. Oh, respect to the co-registration process, that is another very important aspect of the neural navigation system. We can say that in a simplified explanation, in a navigation system, we have two different spaces, the real world space and the image space. The head of the subject and all the used items, the stylus item, the coil item, are referred to the real world space by means of the tracking system. As you remember, the tracking system, by means of the position sensor, is able to create the global coordinate system. And the global coordinate system is used to locate the subject head and the position of the stylus and the coil item, and also the orientation of these items. So the real world space is created by the tracking system. On the other hand, we have the magnetic resonance images of the subject head that are referred to another space, the image space. So, the aim of the co-registration procedure is to create a virtual representation of the used instruments in the image space to show, for example, their position respect to an internal structure of the head, such as the human brain, information that could not be obtained in the real world space. So, the aim of the co-registration procedure is to calculate a matrix that permit to map special data from the one space to the other. The computation of this matrix is based on generally is based on two corresponding data set of landmarks that are localized onto the subject head and also on his MRI's data. And it is important that these landmarks are similarly localized onto the subject head and onto its images. Softaxic system uses three landmarks. The first landmark is a craniometric landmark, is the nasion, And the denesion is very easy to find because if you use the sagittal view of the MRI data, as shown in the figure, and you can localize these landmarks in a depressed area between the eyes in the center of the nose. So this is the depressed area. We are in the center of the nose, you see here. So in the sagittal view, you can see this depressed area. And also in the coronal view, you can verify to be in the middle of the nose. And so you have to locate the position of the denesion in this point. Generally, the two other landmarks are localized by using some reference that can be identified in the hair lobe. For example, as the tragus, the super and interphagic nodes, and the crus of ilex. As you see, this is the tragus, this is the superphagic notch, and this is the interphagic notch. And then we have the crus of ilex, that is a particular point, particular part of the hair lobe. And some of these landmarks are used in electroencephalography in the EEG studies, like, for example, the tragus. However, in the EEG session, there are no devices or the instrument that can modify the position or the shape of the hair lobe. While in the case of the navigation system, retention system are used to lock, for example, the head during the acquisition of the MRI data. And this is a very crucial aspect because when the subject is inside the magnetic resonance scanner, and for example, the subject often wears also an anti-noise air muff to reduce the noise during the acquisition of the images. And the ear muff can alter the shape and position of the hair lobe, as shown in the figure. You see, for example, this is the hair lobe, but it's very deformed. The shape of the hair lobe is very deformed. Or here, you see that there is the form of the hair muff. So, for this reason, I suggest to use a deep landmark, such as the highest part of the crus of helix, this is a deep landmark. Perhaps the level of deformation is more less than the other landmarks that are located onto the hair lobe. And to locate these landmarks, the higher parts of the crus of helix, you can use the sagittal images. First, you choose a deeper sagittal section where you can see the crus of helix crossing the here, forming a sort of number 8. You see This is the class of Vilex crossed to here. And here we have a sort of number 8. You see the number 8. Okay. Then scrolling the sagittal images outwards until only the most external part of the crust of Vilex is visible, and it does not cross the here. Okay, you see, while this is a sort of bridge, and now the bridge is not completely okay, and you have to locate the landmark at the visible tip of the crust of helix of the helix here, and the tip of the higher part of the crust of helix can be easily localized also on the 3D model of the head. You can see here, this is the location of these landmarks. So I suggest to use these landmarks also because it's very simple to localize it onto the MRI data. By using this procedure, it's very simple. First, you have to identify the sagittal view where there is this conformation about the crust of helix. And then you have to move to scroll the images until you have that there is not a complete bridge between the two parts of the here. And then you have to pose the landmark here at the tip of the crust of helix. If you want to use the bidimensional images. Otherwise, you can use directly the 3D models of the head reconstructed by the MRI data, and you have to pose the landmarks here. Later, we see again about this procedure. Okay, another important aspect is related to the targeting of the navigated TMS. At the first, navigated TMS was performed simply by placing a focal coil, for example, a figure of 8 coil, over the target area on the basis of the subject individual MRI data. It was assumed that activated brain area was located on the line that passes through the focus of the coil perpendicularly to the surface of the coil. So this is the focus of the coil. This is the plane of the surface of the coil. And this is the perpendicular line. And at the first, the activated brain area was located in this point. This method is called line navigation. Line navigation can result in an inaccurate targeting if the coil is not perfectly tangential with respect to the scalp of the subject. In fact, when the coil is perfectly tangential to the scalp, the point of the brain below the focus of the coil is at the minimum distance from it, and therefore, in that point, the value of the induced electric field could be very high. More recently, navigated TMS was guided by on the basis of the induced electric field distribution, resulting in higher accuracy than line navigated TMS. And this new mode to Navigate is named E-Field Navigated TMS. There is a very nice study from Krieg and that show the difference between line and E-Field navigation procedure. As you see in the figure, the E-Field navigation and line navigation may locate the stimulation spot in very different brain areas, depending on the local brain geometry and the coil tilting. In the figure, for example, the E-Field navigated TMS target is located onto the primary motor cortex, as shown by the red line and dot. This is the primary motor cortex, while this is more posterior, and this is the primary sensory cortex. So the navigated TMS target is posed here onto the primary motor cortex. And while the line navigation, that is the blue line and blue dot, is located onto the primary sensory cortex. And you can see here, there is the EMG signal. And you see that there is an electromyography activity. And then we know that this activity coming from the primary motor cortex, that is the target of the E-field navigated TMS. In the right figure, there is the opposite configuration, where the E-field navigated TMS target is located onto the primary sensory cortex. You see the red line and red dot, and in this figure are located onto the primary sensory cortex. And while the line navigated TMS target is located onto the primary motor cortex, okay, but no EMG activity is present. This result shows that line navigation result is an inaccurate target. This is very important. And also, at the first, the E-field distribution was calculated using a spherical model to approximate the true brain geometry in order to reduce the computational load. There is a recent study that has shown that the use of a spherical model to approximate the true brain geometry may result in targeting errors of about 1-2 centimeter and a stimulation intensity offset from 20% until the 40%, especially in the temporal and frontal regions of the brain. So the use of the spherical model to approximate the true brain geometry is not so accurate procedure. Another very nice feature of the Softaxic, as you know, is that this system is the only one that is able to estimate in real time the distribution of the induced electric field using the realistic model of the subject brain reconstruction from his MRI data. So we see in the next part of the meeting, we will see this procedure to calculate the induced electric field using the realistic model. And I suppose that this first part is over. Now we can have a break of about 15 minutes, and then we see together how to create the data set of navigation data, starting from the magnetic resonance images of the head of the subject, the individual MRI data, and until there are a step guided procedure, and until the co-registration procedure. And this is the topic of the second part of this meeting. So now we can break for a coffee. Sorry, Filippo. About 15 minutes.
Before the break, there are some questions in the chat.
Okay. So I go to the chat.
The first one is from Giacomo Bertazzoli. I don't know.
Giuseppe Bertazzoli. Thank you, Giuseppe. Infatti, I do the same, but to bond il fatto. Devo conoscere la sua. Allora, question. It sounds a little sketchy, but could the speaker speak close to mic? Oh, sorry, Valerio. I agree about the Google's header. How still can Google remain during the registration? Okay, allora, during the registration, there is an elastic band in the posterior part of the Google's, and so I prove that the Google's remain onto the subject head during the registration, but we can see the next part of the this webinar the use of this Google's device. I have already tried to use for the marker. It tend to move. Yes, Giorgio, we can discuss about this together. Yes, about manual calibration, it may be a silly question, but how still the coil should be during should be fixed? No, there is no. It's not necessary because you use the stylus during this kind of manual calibration, and all is referred to the global coordinate system of the position sensor, as the position tool that is posed onto the coil and the position tool of the stylus will be at the same time recorded by tracked by the position sensor, and so there is no necessary to fix the coil during this procedure. Sometimes it's not possible to just put a coil on the table due to the presence. Yes, yes, but I show you in the next part of this webinar in the next few days. I have an higher cooled coil for which no predefined coil exists. Usually all the cortical with one main and marking the right one is the best way. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Giuseppe. Okay. I don't know. You say that maybe is a very this can be see together, but in my experience, also the manual calibration is an accurate procedure, but we can see together again this procedure, and also we can calculate the accuracy. Yes, Giacomo Bertolazzi. We have a publication about the computation of the realistic the field, and so I can share with you and also with the other, and in order to have an idea about this computation is performed by the Softaxic. Okay, and how can we choose the field model rather than the inline? Yes. Oh, as we will see that.
Maybe it's better if you read also the question.
Because the chat also only
can all see the chat, but we don't know.
Okay, allora, Professor Chiara Ferrari, how can we choose the e-field mode rather than the line mode when we use the Softaxic? Oh, the new, the last version of the Softaxic system shows the two target, the line target and the e-field target at the same time, and then you can have an idea about the line target and the e-field target. So you have to verify the coil tilting, and also to adjust the orientation of the coil in order to, for example, have the field target and the line target on the same part of the brain. As you see in this figure, the figure that the slide that is shown now, you see in this case, I use the new version of the Softaxic, and here you can see that there is only one target because I pose the coil onto the subject scalp, and I adjust the orientation of the coil to obtain the only one target. So in this point, I have the two targets, the line target and the e-field target. So you can see that there is only one target. And so I cannot show you about the two targets because I have the orientation of the coil in this case was performed to obtain only one target. But if you perform this kind of positioning, for example, when you have the two targets in only one point, for example, you are assured that the target is at the minimum distance respect to the coil focus. And as you know, this is a very high induced electrical field values in the brain. So perhaps this kind of procedure will be accurate to stimulate the part of the brain that you want. This is the main window of the new version of the software, but as you see, it's very similar to the previous one. And again, we have four sections, the dataset section, your navigation, utility, and map section. and the data set section is to use to create and or manage for the creation and management of the navigation data. And you can see that there are three options: new subject, new estimated MRI subject, and the load subject. The first option, new subject, must be used to create a new navigation dataset by importing the MRI data of a new subject. And the dataset is created and automatically saved. And you know that there is a specific folder, a specific directory, the name is Storyposts, where all the navigation and also all the session data will be saved here in this folder. And in this case, the navigation dataset is created and automatically saved after performing and a step-by-step guided procedure, and that is very similar to the previous version of the Softaxic. And this is the first option. And then we have the second option, that is the new estimate and MRI subject option. And it must be used to create a new dataset, as you know, using a probabilistic procedure, and to create the individualized MRI data. So this option is used when individual MRI data is not available, and also in this case, the navigation dataset is created and automatically saved after performing the very similar step-by-step guided procedure. But in this case, there is also the possibility to perform a very fast procedure, and we will see this new feature in the next part of this webinar. While the last option is a load subject and must be used to load an existing subject dataset from the repository folder to start a new neural navigation session. Today we will see how to create navigation data from individual images of the subject, so we see how perform this option, the new subject option. Only the time to start the Softaxic, and then we can start with this part of the presentation. Only 1 second. Now we are using the software. As you see, if I press here, I could select the data of the subject. But before to start with this option, the creation of a new navigation dataset, I will explain about the configuration of the software. So you could start the configuration of the system by click on this icon, this gear icon, or for example to use this menu, by select tools setting. So at the first, we have these windows. As you see, there are different panels. The first is about the digitizer. So this is the configuration of the tracking system. And you can see that there is a field related to the port of the communication that you can use to establish the communication between the PC, the host PC, and the tracking system. And there are also the possibility to set the velocity and other parameters of this communication. And as you know, if you start from the control panel, there are the device manager window, and then you can select the port item, and then there is you will see that there is the a new label that is the NDI host USB converter, and you can find the parameter that you have to enter here. And so we can see this part of the configuration when we will I will be in my lab, and so we can go to the second panel, the items panel, and this is a very simple configuration. As you remember, during the first part of this webinar, I explained you that for the Softaxic, the term item is related to the position tool when it is posed onto an instrument or onto a part of the body, for example, on the head of the subject. So we see that there is the configuration of the time of the item that we are using. And for example, you see that the Softaxic include 6 items: head, stylus, coil 1, coil 2, and also other 2 items that are related to the calibration platforms, the CAL 1 and CAL 2, and each item is formed by a position tool that is defined by the corresponding ROM file, and also to the a sort of indication about the instrument of the part of the body where the item is disposed. So we see that the first item, the head item, is formed by the ROM file 338, and it is posed on the head of the subject, as I explained to you during the first part of this webinar. Okay. While you see that for the stylus item and also for the coil 1 and coil 2 item, there is also the possibility to set another parameter, that is the max target distance, and the metric of this parameter is the millimeter, and this is the sort of configuration that generally is better if you leave without change, because it's related to the distance between, for example, the focus of the coil and the brain surface that the system can take into account during the search for a target. So in this case, for example, the coil one has 5 centimeters to reach a target of the brain. If the target of the brain is within this distance, the coil one is able to identify this target. But if the distance between the focus of the coil and the surface of the brain is more than 5 centimeters, the coil is not able to localize a target. So I suppose that it's better if we don't change these parameter values, and only we can verify that our configuration for the stylus item, for the coil one item, and for the coil two item is like in is corresponding to the real situation. For example, I suppose that there is no generally the stylus is always formed by the ROM file 340, and because we know that this is an item that is that we cannot change, while we can modify the configuration of the coil one item and of the coil two item, because we can modify, for example, no, the position tool that we are using for the coil one or for the coil two, and also the type of the coil that we are using. In this case, for example, I am using the coil Maxtim 9925, and on this coil, I have posed the position tool 449. But if I want to use another item, another position tool, I could change by select, for example, another ROMs file, and then I put this ROM file in the configuration of the item. The same for the coil 2, and I can change the ROM file, no? And then I also to select the model of the coil that I am using, you know? So if, for example, if I am using the Maxtim 3190 for with this kind of position tool, I have to select the model of the coil here in the item type field. And if I want to change the ROM file, for example, if I don't use this second coil, I can also delete the ROM file label, okay? But also if I insert the ROM file and then I don't use the coil because I don't feel the item type is the same, I don't use this coil with window present during my navigation. The last information is about the calibration platform. In this case, I use this kind, this name, this calibration platform, and I can select here. I suppose that I use two new calibration, okay. And then this is the correct ROM file for the platform that I am using. And then I can insert here that I'm using these position tools, so this platform, to calibrate the Maxtim 9925, that this is the same, the corresponding platform that for the coil that I am using. Okay, is it clear, this part? Now I go to the chat. What else? Okay, the stimulator panel is about the possibility to connect the, this is a new feature of the Softaxic, because you have the possibility to connect the software, the Softaxic system to the stimulator, and by means of a sort of trigger signal, and we could view this all this modality in the next part of the webinar. Then you here are the possibility to change the position of the store POS folder, that you know that the, this is the directory where the navigation data and also the session data are saved. Generally, there is not the necessary to modify the position of this folder. And then we have other parameters, configuration, the other parameter. The first is if you want to change the key of the keyboard that we press to acquire a point of interest. But also in this case, I suppose that there is no, the is not necessary to change. Normally, it's not necessary to change the key of the keyboard that I am using. And then we have the possibility to modify the unit that we use during the EG and maps, generally microvolt, or for example, we can use millivolt for the map amplitude maps. And the last parameter is about the radius of the sphere that I use during the visualization of the map point. The map point, as I will show you when I will be in the lab. The map is a sort of grid, and there is many points, and that are related to the point that I have stimulated, and this is the this is a parameter related to the configuration of the size of the radius of this point. The last parameter is a very important parameter, because is the tool that I want to use to convert the data from, for example, DICOM format to Nifty format. As you know, the Softaxic is able to use Nifty or analyze format for the MRI data. And generally, you have this data in the DICOM format, so you have to change, to convert from DICOM format to Nifty format. And the best is to use an external tool. I suggest here, there is this external tool, the DCM2NI, that is a tool coming from the installation of MRI Chron, that you can use to perform the conversion. Otherwise, I suggest you to install, because I, in my opinion, is a very useful tool. The tool MRI Crow GL, that have the same possibility to convert from DICOM to Nifty, but using a Windows, a GUI Windows, an interface, And so it's more simple also, it's very simple also to use this, this tool. And so I suggest to install also this free tool, MRI Chrome GL, on your PC, and also to use the conversion, the import option of this tool to convert from DICOM to Nifty. But if you here, you select the external tool, for example, the DCM to NI tool from the MRI Chrome, only Chrome, non Chrome GL. Here, if you select this this tool, you can use, select directly the DICOM images, and then the Softaxy will be used this external tool to convert from DICOM to Nifty. For example, okay, this is the end. Okay. A ROM file for it is required. Here, but okay, you have to, yes, because I have installed the program. So, I have to select the PPA and also the other one. Okay. I have to change the configuration because I have installed the new version yesterday, and so I have a new configuration for the system. Okay. Okay, so for example, I selected the new subject option, and then I go to this folder, and here I have the DICOM for the subject. You see, this is the single DICOM file, and so I select the first one file, DICOM, and now the software will use the external DCM to NI, and there is this warning: would you like to convert with DCM, DCM to NI so tool before loading? I say yes. And so automatically the Softaxy perform the conversion from DICOM to Nifty, and you see that we are at the first step of the guided procedure that is that we are performing to create the navigation data. And in this first window, we have two aims. The first is to verify that the orientation of the MRI data is correct, and we will verify this by see that in the sagittal view there is a sagittal images. Okay, we see that this is sagittal images, and this is the sagittal view. If you see that, for example, in the sagittal view there are no sagittal images, then you have to use in the second windows an automatic procedure to modify the orientation of the data set of the MRI data. So this was the first aim, and the other aim is to enter, if you want, other information about the subject. For example, the name, the surname, age, weight. And as you can see, the first part of the data set, of the navigation data set that we are creating, it is fixed. And also is a unique name because it's related to the date and time when we start this procedure, the creation of the navigation data. So if you insert here the name of the or the surname of the subject, you see that this information are added to the first part that, as I said, is fixed, is predefined, so you cannot change this part in order to obtain an unique denomination, classification of the navigation data. Oh, in the same windows, we have also the possibility to change the slide that we are that are visualized in the free respect to the free planes by moving this cursor, or by clicking with the left button of the mouse. And also there is a possibility if you press and hold pressed the shift key of the keyboard, and then you move the central wheels of the mouse, you can modify the zoom factor of the images. If you press and hold pressed the central button of the mouse, you can move the image inside the view. Okay, so shift, and then I move the wheels of the mouse, the wheel of the mouse, I change the factor, the zoom factor, while if I press the wheel or the central button of the mouse, I can move the image inside the view. If I want to reset all the transformation about the level of the zoom, no, or the position of the images, I very simple to press this R button. You see, this is a very small R, reset. And if I click here, I reset all the free views. And what else? Another information that is shown onto these windows is related to the to information about the voxel element that is located at the center of the red cross. You see, if I click with the mouse, I can select a specific point of the image, and in this part of the windows, in the part in the left, in the right superior part of the windows, we have two coordinates system. And there is the first is the coordinate related to the voxel space, and the second is related to the physical images, physical image space. So the first is a space with no metric, because is the only the element of the metrics of the voxel. As you see, are integer values, while the second free coordinates are related to the image space, magnetic resonance space, and there is a metric in millimeters in this case, and you have an idea about the, for example, the distance of two points onto the images. If you, for example, calculate the distance, you can use the free coordinates related to the MRI space and to calculate the distance between points have the information about the position of part of the brain of interest. And the other cursors and other command now are not have not effect. So the first AI aim is verified because I see that the orientation is correct. The orientation of my dataset is correct. Then I have inserted the surname and name of the subject, so I can press next and go to the next step of elaboration. Oh, this.
Yes. There are some questions in the chat.
Ah, okay, perfect. Thank you very much.
From Giacomo Bertazzoli.
Just a moment, because I don't see. Eccolo qua. About the MRI base dataset, is there any way to import images for different MRIs? There is something or there is missing complete part. I don't understand very well your. So I'm sorry, but I, Alessandro, I don't understand very well your question. I understand that sometime all the series are the missing or incomplete part. But I suggest you to use MRI CrowGL to import from DICOM, because it's a very useful and powerful tool. So we can discuss also if you write me by mail, you can we can try to use the MRI CrowGL, and if you have, for example, if you know that you have an MRI dataset that present this problem. And what version of software are you showing? This is the 3.4 version, as the last version of the software. And I said before that this is the beta version, and I perhaps was the first to use this new version. It is available for download. I suppose that is better if you ask to the AMS office about this. What the parameter you set in the maps map section in the setting are for? Okay, we can. I set the metric unit about the value of the EEG data, and also about the EMG data, the map data, are only to have a reference for the when I display the EEG map and the map, and so it's only is only a reference, the correct display of the reference metric, for example, the microvolt or the millivolt for the microvolt for DG and the millivolt for the map. So in the previous, we can start here. You see that there is only the is necessary only to specify the right metric that you want to use, for example, related to the unit of DG potential, in this case microvolt, or for the map amplitude millivolt. So and these metrics use to specify the value during the visualization of the DG map and also of the grid for the map data. Then, but we see in the next part of the webinar when I could use my tracking system. Okay.
There are other questions.
Okay.
From Giacomo.
Yes, yes, but,
what happens if we change the maximal target distance?
Allora, it's not possible. It's not possible at this stage to navigate the MRI and MRI coordinates. We are very not for now. If your question is. It's possible at this stage, so we are at the second step of the elaboration, it's not possible to navigate the MRI in the Montreal Neurological Institute coordinates because we need to perform the spatial normalization to obtain the metric of this stereotaxic space. So we have to wait until until all the step-by-step guided procedure will be performed. Now you have another question about the change. You say me that there is another question about if we want to change the distance.
The maximal target distance, yes.
Yes, we can change, but I suppose that it's better to leave
the question is, Filippo, what happens if we change?
I'm explaining about this. If you, for example, if you have the coil posed in this part of the brain. You see the mouse, my mouse, and I pose the coil here, and then I look for the surface of the brain, and during this search, I, for example, I could intercept the surface of the brain here, but also in the in this very inferior part of the brain. So if the distance map is very, the values of the max distance is very high, at the end, I, for example, I have to, I have identify two target onto the brain. The first target is the where the line starting from the coil focus and perpendicularly to, for example, perpendicularly to the plane of the coil intercept the brain surface, and then the other target will be this part of the brain where the line starting from the coil intercept the inferior part of the external surface of the brain. So if you change the max distance search, the parameter that is related to the distance in the looking for the target, you, for example, could be could have two targets, and then I don't know, probably the system is not able to assign the real, the correct brain target. For example, assign this inferior target respect to the first target that is the correct one. I hope that you that I'm clear to explain about this. Giacomo Bertazzoli, following the MNI question, still after the registration, it's not possible to navigate until the subject registration. So why is this so not? Yes, this is a very good question, because for example, I will interest to navigate the brain before I perform the co-registration. Yes, this is also is a very nice suggestion, and I suppose that EMS will be interested to take into account your suggestion. Okay, I suppose that there are not other questions.
Yes, there's okay. There's another question before regarding the item type for the coils. What is the rule of thumb when we are using a coil that is not listed?
Sorry, but repeat please, because I don't read this question in the chat.
Yes, regarding the item type for the coils.
Yes.
What is the rule of thumb if we are using a coil that is not listed?
Yes. Oh, the question is, what happened is if I have no, if I don't, if I cannot select the model, the type of my coil, because it's not present in this list of coils, okay?
Exactly.
And I suppose that if your coil is not in the in this list, you have to contact the MS and ask about to insert your coil model, because if you select, for example, no one known, is the same to for the system, you are not using a coil. Okay, so there is always it is always necessary to select a coil model. If you use another coil that is not present here, you have to contact the MS, so in order to insert also the coil that you are using. Okay, Elena, all the questions are considered.
Yes, I think.
Okay, perfect. So this is the second windows. We see that there are always the same cursor. As also, I have before I have missed to specify that there is also the possibility to change the brightness and the contrast of the image by using these commands. And this not because this is the opacity control, but is really what is used when you have using an overlay. That is not this is not the case. We have not overlay on these images. and but here you can choose the orientation, and for example you can press here, and if your data set is not correctly is the orientation of your data set is not correct, you can change change the orientation by select what do you see in the free view. For example, now here I am see a sagittal right nose. So if I want to change the orientation of my images because it's not correct, but this is not the case, because as you remember, in the previous step, I verify that in the sagittal view, the images that is shown in the sagittal view is the sagittal images. So my data set now is correct. But for example, if I use a data set that was that has another orientation that I need to correct, I have to select here what I see in the view. For example, here I view a sagittal nose right. Here I view a coronal head up, and here I view a axial nose up, because the nose is here, as you verify. And then I press reorient by labels, and the program will arrange the dataset to adjust the orientation of the images. And you have also the possibility to invert left with right and right with left, but also only if you is necessary to perform this inversion. And what else are the aim of the second of this second step? So is to perform the correction in the orientation of the data set if necessary, if it is necessary, and also to perform the reconstruction of the head of the 3D head model, three-dimensional head model. As you see, the program automatically suggests the threshold value, and this threshold is related to the end of the background and the start of the pixel that are related to the head of the subject. So you can change the values of this threshold by moving the cursor. And for example, now I see that the reconstruction is better than the previous one, because I see that at the first, I suppose that the value was about this one. I see that on the superior part of the scalp, I know the presence of some kind of noise. Okay, so I can change the threshold in order to include all the pixel, all the voxel that are related to the head of the subject, and I don't include the voxel that are related to the background. If I use a very low threshold value, I insert in my reconstruction also the voxel that are related to the background. For example, you see that I, with a low threshold value, I am including also voxel that are related to the background and not only to the head of the subject. So I have to use the value of the threshold that is not so much high, because if I use a very high value for this threshold, I lose part of the head of the subject. And generally, the suggested value for the threshold is a good starting point to found the correct value for this threshold. As you see, I have an incomplete reconstruction of the brain of the subject, of the head of the subject. So I use, for example, this value that I see before that is sufficient to reconstruct the head model. I verify that all part of the head are correctly reconstructed. And in particular, I verify that the hair lobe of the subject, the left and the right hair lobe, are correctly reconstructed. As you see, this subject has the sign of the hair muff. And so I can there is another possibility is that if your magnetic MRI data has a dynamic of the gray levels not so good, for example, if there are if you see the explain. For example, if there are very high value of the gray level that are assigned only to a very few number or voxel, so the histogram of the your images appear not so good, and your data set is very dark. In this case, is not so sufficient to modify the brightness of the contrast of the image, but for example, you can change the dynamic of the gray levels by modify the maximum values of the input windows. The input windows is related to the gray level. And for example, here now I have the maximum of the gray level is 1039. But for example, if I change this one and I, for example, use another values, you see that I change the dynamics of the gray level of the image, and I perform a sort of compression in these gray levels, dynamics, and I can obtain a more light images. And this is the only values that you can change, because the minimum of the input windows is you cannot change these parameters. So when you have the your data set is very, very dark, and you try to modify this input windows value, the maximum input, the maximum values of the input windows, to obtain a new dynamic for the gray level, and you will see that your images will be more more brightness, I mean, another brightness, another are not so dark. Okay, but now I have to really insert the previous, for example, because I don't know, it's not necessary to use to change the dynamics of degree level. I'm waiting to the finish of the elaboration, take into account that now, as I stay at home, I'm using a very old PC that is an Intel 3, i3 processor, and is not so fast respect to the more recent processor family. But you see that all the elaboration are always almost fast. Okay, we are near to finish this position. Okay, I back to the, I prefer to return back and then, okay. Perhaps I move, okay, next. So now we have to perform the first step of the co-registration procedure, as I explained to you in the first part this morning. We have to localize the position of three landmarks. The first, as you remember, is the Nation, and as I explain, this is very simple to identify because you can zoom the sagittal view and verify that you are locating this point in this depressed area in the middle of the eyes and in the middle of the nose. So this is the depression area, and this is the point in the middle of the nose, in the middle of the eyes. Okay, so this is the good localization for the nation. Then I press here to perform the localization of the second landmarks. And in this case, I perform first the reset of the zoom factor. And then I have two possibility. I want, for example, to localize these second landmarks in the tip of the highest cross of ILEX point, as I show you this morning. And I have two possibility to locate this point onto the three-dimensional head model, or by using the magnetic resonance, the bidimensional magnetic resonance. In this case, I perform the procedure that I have explained this morning. So I scroll the sagittal view until I view the number eight, and this is the crust of ILEX. And in this view, you see that there is a complete bridge, and so I have to move outwards the image, and so you see that here I have the tip of the glass of Ilex, and then I have to click here and to assign this point as the second landmarks. If you ask me about why there is no indication of this point onto the 3D head model, is because I am thinner than the surface of the skin of the subject. But I suppose that it is only 1 millimeter under the skin of the subject. In fact, if I move here and I select the same point, but only 1 or 2 millimeters, I see that the point appears also onto the three-dimensional head model. So this is the reason why I prefer to localize it directly here using the three-dimensional head model, because I select the corresponding points in the same position, how I can localize after onto the subject head. Are there any question about this procedure? I see, I go to the chat. Okay, I'm happy to see that all is clear until now. Okay. And then I select the second landmarks and go here, and I select this point, and I to power off primary on task over controller. Just a moment. Okay. Oh, the same procedure is we have to perform to localize the second, the last landmark, and in this case I have select directly onto the three-dimensional head model, and also I verify into the bidimensional images that I am very near to the tip of the crust of the Ilex. And as I explained this morning, I could use also other landmarks, for example, the tragus or the superior tragic notch or other notch, but as I explained to you, it's better to use deeper landmarks in order to not have effect due to deformation by retention device during the acquisition of the magnetic resonance images. And so I prefer these landmarks, the crust of Ilex. Then I press next. I verify that all is correctly localized. This is the A1, the nation, and the A2. The A1 is on the left side of the head, and the A2 is on the right part of the head of the subject. Okay, so I can press next. And now I have to perform the segmentation of the brain. For the segmentation of the brain, the tool uses a standard tool that is always used, that is, no, not tool, movies, but that is used also in other neuroimaging tools, like, for example, FSL. The name of the tool is a brain extraction tool. The version is the version 2. And the only operation that all the tool perform the segmentation automatically, but you have to select the center of the brain manually. And this is a very simple step, because you have to select the center of the brain in the three views. So I select here, then I go to the coronal view and select here the center, and then I go to the axial view, and also here I modify or verify that the red cross is at the center of the brain. Generally, I use the thalamus as a reference to perform this the position of the center of the brain only onto the sagittal view. So I select the middle of the brain, and then I put here the center of the red cross, take the thalamus as a reference to locate this point. Then we have the three parameters that are the fractional threshold, the gradient threshold, and the smooth factor. And you can use, if you want to know in the deep how this parameter can be used, you can use the manual from the FSL tool, for example. But generally, I don't change this parameter, and I use the values, the predefined values. But there is the possibility to also to modify these parameters. For example, the fractional threshold. I know that if you use smaller values respect to this one, 0.5, you have an estimation of the brain larger respect to the higher values. So if you want a smaller brain segmentation, you have to use a higher value. If you want a smaller, a larger brain, sorry, you have to use a smaller value. But now I use the same, the 0.5 values, the standard, the predefined. Oh, the gradient threshold is a parameter that the default is zero, like values, and generally deform the segmentation, give you a larger brain at the bottom or smaller at the top. For example, if you use a value that are very near to one. You have to take into account that the minimum of this parameter is minus one, and the maximum is one. And if you use a positive value, you have a larger brain outline at the bottom, a smaller at the top. This is the reason why I leave the predefined values and I don't modify these parameters. The other parameter is about the smooth factor, and in the manual the FSL report that if you use smaller values, you produce a smoother, so a less detailed surface for the brain. And so also in this case, I prefer to leave the predefined value and don't change this parameter. I know that sometimes the data set is not so perfect respect to the reconstruction of the brain, but we can discuss later about this, this topic. So this is the my localization of the center of the brain. I press compute button to start the elaboration. Also in this case, you take into account that I'm using a not so fast PC, but you see that the segmentation is in real time. Oh, this is the a sort of preview about the segmentation of the brain. You see that there are not so much details about the surface of the brain because the aim of this visualization is only to check that all part of the brain, as for example the cerebellum, is included in the segmentation. For example, if I perform, if I set the center of the brain not correctly, I will obtain a not complete segmentation of the brain. So this preview is useful to verify that all the parts of the brain are included in the segmentation. In this case, I could press next to perform the reconstruction of the brain model. And as you can see now, there are more detailed surface of the brain. And if you don't like this reconstruction, the suggested reconstruction, you can modify the minimum threshold. As for the head model, if you use a very low value, you have a surface of the brain with minor details, with not so much detailed. And why, if you use a very high value for the threshold, you, for example, you don't consider the gray matter, but you obtain a three-dimensional reconstruction that is more near to the brain, to the white matter tissues. As you see, I have lost part of the gray matter surface, but I am a brain that is very similar, come from only the white matter, for example, very, very similar. So I have to change this parameter until I obtain the right surface, right reconstruction of the brain surface. And for example, this is a good reconstruction of the brain surface. If I also have the possibility to change the maximum of the threshold, but also in this case is a parameter that generally I don't use because is, in my opinion, is not necessary to modify the maximum of the threshold. And so I can press next to perform the next step of the elaboration. And here we have the possibility to perform the spatial normalization. The spatial normalization is useful to refer the all the data to the Talerac and Montreal Neurological Institute stereotaxic spaces. And in this case, I can use an automatic procedure to perform this spatial normalization. And Softaxic uses the ANT algorithm that is a very useful tool to perform the spatial normalization of the magnetic resonance images, and also is a good the results of the this spatial normalization is very accurate. And as you see, we have four options: affine fast, that is the fastest option; affine standard, nonlinear fast, and the last is nonlinear standard, the best quality. So I don't know if you have an idea about the different procedure that we can use to perform the spatial normalization, but in a very simple explanation, we have the possibility to, our aim is to perform a match between the brain of our subject, the results of the segmentation, of this step of the segmentation, and we have to match these images with the brain of a MRI-based dataset, and this template is the same that is normally used by neuroimaging tool like SPM or FSL when you have to manipulate data coming from different group or population, group of subject or population, and then you have, for example, to perform a statistical analysis of this data. In this case, the first step that you have to perform is that you have to deform the brain of your subject in order to match this brain with the brain of this template in order to make all the brain comparables each other. Also in this case, we use this spatial normalization tool to refer our data to the space of the template, and the space of the template generally is referred also to stereotaxic spaces, for example, Talerac MNI space. So the aim of this procedure is to calculate this matching between the brain of the subject and the brain of the template, and then use the transformation, the geometric transformation, to perform this matching in order to use the also two new space, and this is the MNI space and the Talerac space, as the reference of the position of the part of the brain, of the voxel of the brain. So at the first, we have only the physical space of the images as the reference for the coordinates of the part of the brain. After this operation, after this spatial normalization, we have also the possibility to use the MNI and the Talerac space, stereotaxic spaces. Also, this operation permit us to.
Buongiorno Dan, come sta?
Permit us to overlay also, for example, other images onto our dataset, like for example Atlas, functional data, diffusion tractography, and so on. Automatically we can overlay this information, and so at the end we have a sort of multimodal neural navigation system that, in my opinion, is a very good mode to use the TMS. So we have the four options, and the affine family for the registration mode are very simple algorithm, and generally the affine perform a linear procedure, and so the result obtained is not so accurate, but sure, the results are not accurate like the use of nonlinear family for the spatial normalization. Nonlinear family are the best procedure that you can use to perform the matching between the subject and the template. And the only the difference between the affine and nonlinear is that the nonlinear procedure have a computational load bigger than the affine family procedure, and so in my opinion it's better to use the nonlinear standard best quality option. Also, because all the step that I explain you, you can perform these steps offline. It's not necessary that the subject will be here and is waiting that you finish all the step. You can perform these all these steps offline, and then in my opinion it's better to use a computational load, more computational load procedure that obtain that, so to obtain a better results, then perform, for example, the alpine fast of the affine standard that perform a more inaccurate results. For the kind of my PC processor, now I, for example, I use the nonlinear fast in order to obtain a sort of good results in a very small time. So I press next. So now I am able to start my navigation sensor session, and now I need to connect the PC with the host, the PC host with the tracking system, and so in the next part of the webinar, in the next few days, we start from this step, and then we can perform our navigation sensor. Now you see that the system show you the head model, and also with reported the position of the landmarks, Nasion A1 and A2. And here you have the control panel about the use of the stylus to localize the same landmarks onto the subject head. And it's very useful to use this head model as a reference to locate the same corresponding point onto the subject head. And now we have also the possibility to use these two icons command in order to visualize the scalp model of the brain model of the subject. Okay, and when I press the 2D icon, I can visualize also the bidimensional images of the subject. When I press 3D icon, I perform the visualization also only of the brain model or those of the head model. I can use the wheel of the mouse to change the factor, the zoom factor. And the other icon is related to the use of the tractography fibers data, but we can cannot see now, but we see in the next part, in the next webinar. And here you have the possibility to perform a screenshot to save the screen as a image, as a picture. And now here you are not able to perform overlay because the first step is always the co-registration with the wall space, with the space of the subject. So we have to waiting for the next webinar, the optical tracking. And what else? I suppose that we have reached the end of this part of the webinar. Okay. Thank you very much again to everybody.